I'm going to call to order the October 13th, 2015 Board of Trustees meeting. We'll return from executive session where we discuss the items that are listed on our agenda for executive session today. At this time, I would like to have Mr. Plank, if you will do the inspirational moment.
Sure, thank you. Well, first I wanted to say, in light of the events that we've experienced in Columbia, certainly in South Carolina over the last week and a half, you know, our hearts go out to so many people who have been affected by this. And you know, it's we know our obvious heroes, and we want to thank them, the EMS, the medical profession, our law enforcement, our military, you know, the Red Cross, and I could go on and on, FEMA in this case. But you know, over the last week, as I've gone around and inspected properties, and in my line of work, I've been doing a lot of canvassing the area, there's someone I want to thank tonight and observe and talk about, and that is our quiet heroes. And you know, this person carries with them the character traits of humility, tenderness, kindness, eagerness, hospitality, and most significantly, selflessness. And so, you know, this selflessness is seen when I heard about a woman who got into her vehicle in Charlotte, North Carolina, loads up her kids, drives the hour and a half south to one of our local schools, one of our middle schools, jumps out, walks up, says, "Put me to work." Works all day, quietly leaves with a mark of progress. It's the selflessness when I see students at houses that are just totally destroyed, asking, going door to door, saying, "What can I do?" And when you put them to work, they go right at it. And as that work starts to lighten, they're off to the next house. At a time, especially where they are off school or they could be playing their video games, I saw the shirts of the different high schools in our neighboring districts and ours, and that was really cool. Meals being dropped off at doorsteps with a simple, "We're thinking of you, enjoy." And then one interesting one that was, my bride had gone to one of the box stores to put together flood buckets. These are these 5-gallon buckets where you get various supplies to help with cleanup, masks and mold stuff. And she's being assisted by the assistant manager as she's going through all the items, and they go up to the counter. And my kids are putting them in the different buckets to take all 5. And as they finish checking out, she says, "Oh, wait, I have a coupon." And he said, "We've got this. We've got this." "No, no, no, you can't let me do that. You can't let us do that." He says, "No, we've got this." And that's one of those quiet hero moments, one of those actions. And then the final thing that I really found interesting was on Sunday, it really struck me, is what it really is all about. I'd asked a group of people, "What good have you seen over this last week?" And interestingly, a teacher in this group said, she starts to go and talk about jumping into action and organizing. And 4 words she said, she didn't realize that meant a lot to me, but she said, "You know, we did this, and we're teachers. It's what we do. It's what we do." And that has stuck with me all the rest of that day, Sunday and Monday. And as I think about where Dent Middle School, Ridgeview, and various other schools in our community went from a cafeteria to almost like a Goodwill center in a matter of hours, that's what our educators, administrators, fellow board members, teachers, support has done. It's just what they do. So I just wanted to thank all of you guys for being such a loud group of quiet heroes. So thank you. Now, if you'd join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. Mm-hmm. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Plank, for those inspirational words as we move into our meeting this evening.
I agree.
At this time, if I can have the approval of the agenda.
So move.
And so moved, or moved by Ms. Brill. Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Dr. Cheryl Caution Parker. And at this time, we'll have the vote. Jill, mine hasn't popped up. I'm not sure if I'm on the system properly or not. I vote yes. All right, at this time, the vote passes 7-0. All right, at this time we have the consent agenda. If I can have a motion to approve that consent agenda.
So move.
So moved by Ms. Brill. Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Ms. Mackey. Is there any discussion for the consent agenda this evening? All right, we'll move to the vote. Would y'all vote yes for that as well, please? And motion passes 7-0. All right. And next on our agenda is public participation. We'll have no one that signed up at this time, but if anybody would like to come speak before the board, please do so now. Okay. With nobody coming forward. If I can have somebody make a motion on executive session items for student appeals.
Mr. Chair, I move that the student be returned to his home school with strict probation.
I second that.
All right, motion made by Ms. Mackey, seconded by Ms. Brill. And at this time, we'll have the vote. And I also vote yes for that while I'm working on signing back in here. Motion passes 7-0. All right, what's next on our agenda? I'm sorry, I'm signing back in here. Dr. Hamm, we have old business action requested. We have several policies this evening.
Yes, Mr. Chair. We do have a number of policies where you did first reading at your last meeting. We're asking for second and final reading on those policies. I do think it's interesting that one of them is policy IC, the school year, which has to do with how we make up weather-related days.
Timing is interesting. So do I have a motion to approve those we have several policies. We're going to do it as bulk. Do we have a motion to approve the policies?
So move.
So moved by Ms. Brill. Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Plank. Is there any discussion?
Question, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
On the policy I see that deals with makeup days, if we pass it tonight, does it go into effect immediately, or when does it go into effect?
Mr. Chairman, it would go into effect immediately. Really, we're just bringing our policy in compliance with state law, and state law is already in place.
Thank you.
But my understanding, just to be clear, though, we won't be able to immediately approve days off because we have to have used our 3 days built into the schedule before we have the option to approve days.
Right.
Is that correct?
Right.
And those 3 days
are
not...
You'll be getting more information about that when we get to the... flood-related district status report and relief efforts. We have a recommendation there related to making up days.
Are there any other questions?
Mr. Chair, I have one question.
Yes.
It's related to the state testing. Did we ever decide at the district level what type of testing we're going to use for first grade and kindergarten students? Have the district discussed that yet?
Yes, ma'am, and I'm happy to send you that chart.
Great. Thank you.
Other questions or comments? Okay, at this time we'll have the vote. And motion passes 7-0. All right, next on our agenda.
This one, new business.
We have new business. Dr. Hammer, report on release time for religious education.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. We have been approached about providing release time for religious education, so we've been looking into that as a topic. Mr. Keith Price is here to give you a report.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Dr. Ham, and ladies and gentlemen of the board. Tonight I bring to you the results of an inquiry about a program called Release Time for Religious Education. What is Release Time? Release Time is a program that allows public school students to leave their school campus during the day to receive religious instruction and study regardless of the religion of choice. In 1952, the U.S. Supreme Court, in its decision in Zorich versus Clausen, upheld the constitutionality of release time programs for religious instruction during the school day. Question, is such a thing allowed? The answer to that in our state is yes, it is. And it's called the South Carolina Release Time Credit Act. And in Section 59.1, 460 of the South Carolina Code of Laws was amended in 1976 that authorizes a school board to adopt a policy that would allow a student to be excused from school to attend a release time course in religious instruction, provided that each of the following applies. First, the student's parent or guardian must give written consent. Next, the sponsoring entity, which is the group that provides the religious instruction, or the person that provides the religious instruction, maintains attendance records and makes them available to the school district that the student attends. Next, the transportation of students, to include students with disabilities so that no student is left out, to and from the place of instruction is the complete responsibility of the sponsoring entity, the parent, the guardian, or the students themselves. Next, the sponsoring entity makes provisions for and assumes liability for the student's safety while under the supervision and control of the sponsoring entity. No public funds are expended and no public school personnel are allowed to be involved in providing religious instruction. Release time courses shall not be held on school property, must be done away from the school campus. And finally, no student may be released from a core academic subject to attend a religious instruction class. Can a student earn a high school credit for going to a release time religious education program? The answer to that is also yes. Section 5939.112 of the South Carolina Code of Laws authorizes a school board to adopt a policy that allows high school students to earn up to 2 units of high school credit for the completion of a release time course in religious instruction, provided that each of the following exists. Number one, the course syllabus shall reflect course requirements and materials consistent with high school level coursework. Number of hours will be consistent with the hours of classroom instruction time. For example, if a class is a 45-minute class and you get 1 credit for taking a 45-minute class for a year or for a semester, then the same would apply in a release time course as well. Number three, the methods of assessment used in the course shall be determined by the instructor in a manner consistent with high school level coursework. And number four, the course instructor shall be a certified teacher or other qualifications similar to those of other teachers within the district. What does this look like on a student's schedule? It cannot reflect release time education, so it could appear as a study hall or a combination of study halls, which would allow time for the students to transition away from campus to the place where the religious instruction is taking place and then back. If that could be accomplished with one study hall, that could be the way that it appears on the schedule. It may be a combination of two. Where are the classes held? As mentioned before, it has to be off campus, but the actual location is determined by the sponsoring entity, the group that's providing the instruction. Would this be one district-wide program serving all district students? The answer to that is no. The recommendation is that it should be one program assigned to one specific school so that the entity could match up the time that the religious instruction is offered with the way the school schedule is built. What levels can offer release time? The answer to that is all levels, elementary, middle, or high school. The recommendation would be that if it's going to be offered, that it would begin at the high school level because of the complexities with the schedule and the attempts to avoid core instructional time. It's also recommended that it begin with only a few high schools, not all five at once, if this were to begin in our district. And based on the feedback that we've received, there would also be interest in providing this to middle school students eventually if the scheduling could be worked out. What are the next steps if we are interested in going in this direction? Those are listed before you. First, contact a school district where this is already in place for guidance and collaboration. And there are districts in our state and nearby that have this type of policy already. Just to name a few, Horry County, Greenville County, Spartanburg 7, and I believe Lexington 1 are all counties that have such policy in place. Next, draft a school board policy for consideration. Then draft a business plan for consideration that would go through the liabilities and the transportation and those sorts of things. Draft a parent permission letter for consent. Meet with our legal representatives to review all information to make sure it's sound. Present the policy to the school board and then meet with high school personnel to discuss possible implementation. This time, that's a quick summary of what release time religious education is. I'll be happy to answer or attempt to answer any questions that you may have.
Just one question, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Mr. Price, are we looking at starting this school year, or we're discussing this for maybe next school year?
I believe the recommendation would be to aim for the next school year because a sponsoring entity would need to take the time to secure a place, secure the instructional units, secure a certified teacher. So to get that all in place during the 15-16 school year may be a little too much. Okay. The recommendation would be to aim no sooner than the 16-17 school year.
Other questions or comments?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Price, can you explain what religious instruction means?
I probably skimmed over that a little bit in the first slide. It could mean going to a church to study Christianity. It could mean going to Hebrew school. It could mean going to a mosque. It, regardless of the religious practice or the religious preference, it would be going to learn more about that particular religion.
Would we approve? Mr. Chairman, is he on the floor?
I'm sorry, yes.
Okay, thanks. Would we approve the credibility of the instruction, the validity of the instruction? Would we, the district, would we be responsible for approving that?
The recommendation, there are two different options that we could take with that. One would be to have an academics team in our district review it to make sure that the similar requirements that exist for our courses are in line with this. Another option would be to have all of that done through perhaps a private school that focuses more specifically on that content and that area and have the credit awarded through them. And then if the student were to come to our district, it would be treated as a transfer credit coming from a private institution.
And then the last question, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Would we be responsible or involved, as we are with charter schools, for example, in approving the facility or the location where our children would be going to receive this religious instruction?
No, sir. We would not be a part of that. That is left up to the sponsoring entity.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes. Other questions or comments?
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned academically and these other districts, neighboring districts, what results are they getting as it relates to academic improvement, if any, and discipline?
I do not have specific data that is a result of the implementation of such a program. I think it would probably depend on the students who are actually involved with the release time religious education. The only information I have are those districts that I named that actually have a policy that allows that. There would need to be further research to gather information about that to see if this program has a direct impact on academics and behavior in those specific districts. There is probably data that exists in different places. There are different policies similar to this in multiple states throughout the country that allow this to happen. And I do not have the data for that at this time.
So is that something that we could get just to, as we consider this type of program? If it's an academic improvement, if discipline is on the downside, there's no cost to us. And I look at some of the other elements that are there that maybe that would be worth knowing, I would think.
I believe that should be attainable. If you look at the year that a program like this would be adopted, and maybe look at trends prior to that adoption versus afterwards, we may be able to collect some of that.
Thank you. Ms. Brill?
I have some serious concerns about logistics, picking children up from school, bringing children back to school, and do they take the school bus home? And do they, like middle school, then they're missing classes, is my understanding, unless they go at lunch. So, you know, I find it to be very complicated, and I worry about our liability. In other words, I'm not going to feel good till my kids are home at home. So what happens in the school day is up to us. So we have to protect these kids.
Right, and that's why a parent permission slip would be an automatic, that would have to be in place. We'd have to have written permission from the parent to allow a student to be released from our care and into the care of someone else.
We don't know where they're going, and we don't know how they're getting there. That's not our responsibility.
Correct.
That raises, you know, some serious concerns for me.
Those logistics would be and should be communicated with our school folks.
To the parents, yeah.
And to the parents.
What if there's a wreck or something on the way or a wreck coming home? We're not responsible, right?
Our recommendation would be to put a business plan in place that would have that liability covered in that plan.
Ms. Mackey?
You've gone over semantics, and I appreciate that, Mr. Price. Question, what is the impetus for considering a program such as this? Is it because it's taking place in other areas, or what's our impetus or the benefit of this for the district?
I'll pick up with that. Just you probably have been approached by a group that has approached us, so we wanted to make sure the board is knowledgeable about this and that you can make an informed decision about what kind of a policy you want to adopt. We are not promoting this. We're trying to keep you informed about this.
Correct. So
this will be your decision about how you want to handle that from a policy standpoint.
That's what I wanted
to
understand.
This is a presentation of information, not an attempt to persuade one way or the other.
Thank you.
Any other board members, questions or comments? I have one. So if a student is 17 or 18, they can then sign the form on their own behalf because they're of age, or do we still need the parent consent at that time?
You know, that's a good question. Thinking off the top of my head, I would think that if a student has been emancipated, then they can certainly sign for themselves, but otherwise the recommendation would be to get parent written consent.
And would that be something, I know, not that we don't trust our students, but how do we ensure that it was an actual parent that signed it? I mean, it's more serious than a field trip or something where there's lots of communication.
Absolutely. I think that would be a part that would be discussed with number 7 when you meet with high school personnel to discuss implementation.
Right.
There would be a lot of discussion about very specific things such as that.
I think, you know, generally, We look at the things that have been put on schools. One of the things that we just approved tonight was that we teach domestic violence to students. We teach sex ed to students. We teach behavior to students. I mean, we have a lot of things that are on the school districts that I know we have other groups, religious groups and others out there that can have resources and can help guide students in some of those things. And so I think it's definitely worthwhile for us as a district. Mr. Plank has asked for some of the data on what maybe some of the benefit or return to the district is. And I think it's worthwhile considering. You know, we keep saying as a school district, we can't do it all, yet we're being asked to do most of it or a lot of it. And so I think anytime we can reach out to partners to help us with that, whether it be during the school day or after, it's worthwhile the consideration. So I appreciate you bringing the information to us for further consideration. Other questions or comments? All right, next on our agenda, thank you very much, Mr. Price. Dr. Hamm, the flood-related district status, I think that's something that's very relevant and current for all of us.
Well, first of all, I want to say, you know, our hearts continue to go out to the families that, in many cases, were really devastated by this and continue to be affected, you know, continue to be in my thoughts, in my prayers, and I want to echo Mr. Plank's comments about just how remarkable and how proud I am of Richland 2's reaction. The number of students who stepped up and went and helped families, collected money and resources that would help them out. Our teachers who just showed up like angels in places that nobody expected to appear and help families rip out carpet and all those kinds of things that had to happen. And I wanna thank the community for their outreach to Richland too. We've had donations of water and money and clothes and food. We were able to feed all of our families who had food insecurity over the weekend because of generous donations. Those things genuinely touch people's lives in tremendously significant ways. So I want to thank the community and the staff that made it possible for us to collect and distribute all that. Another thank you to the administrative staff who handled logistics to make sure that roof leaks were taken care of and classrooms were ready for kids to start school and buses rerouted, et cetera. But I do not want to take away from the story they're about to tell you about what we have done in the wake of the flood and the relief efforts that have taken place. And so we have Mr. Jack Carter, Katina Davis, and Libby Roof are going to give you a report.
As you can imagine, it's a pretty trying week last week, but we were very fortunate. Last Tuesday afternoon, when it became obvious we were going to be out of school for the rest of the week, I asked our Sodexo partners to start feeding on Thursday and Friday because we knew we had children who were not getting meals. So they opened up 10 feeding sites that we identified for them based on a number of things that we discussed with Katina and her folks. And so the good news is we fed 1,862 folks over 2 days. And although it was primarily aimed at students, if a family walked in, we fed the family as well. So there's a mix of adults. Those are mostly students, but there are some adults in there. The biggest challenge really has been the bus routes. We have 114 buses. 100 of them had to have route changes, which really equates to 300 route changes because each one of them runs three routes. We started adjusting routes on Monday, and we were still adjusting them on Wednesday. We thought we had them in place on Thursday. Our bus drivers actually drove the routes in their car on Friday morning, then their bus on Friday afternoon. Things went remarkably well yesterday. Kind of scary it went so well. And of course, this afternoon we had another road failure, so we will make another adjustment in our routes. That one happened to be in Spring Valley. We did set up a special route for Dent. We only had 10 riders the first day. I don't know how many we had the second day, but we had security at both ends of the Decker area that was closed, so no children walked through there. You can see on Friday, everybody was in boil water. Saturday, we got an email from Winsboro taking a number of our schools off of the boil water. And then on Sunday night, we got another lifting of a partial lifting of the ban. So we're really down to 9 schools in the district office right now. And as you said, this school happens to be on boil water. We on Saturday had a pallet of water delivered to all 40 locations. Of course, by Monday, we didn't need it at all 40 locations, so we've been redistributing water to the schools that they need. We continue to get water in, and we're fairly confident we have sufficient water to get us through the next few days, and it does look like we will have some resolution with the Columbia Canal here very soon. We did get some hand sanitizer donated. Roosevelt helped us get that. We took that primarily to high schools, because you say elementary schools got plenty of that stuff. So we took some to middle and some to high school. Our folks were in the school actually starting the Saturday the rain event started. Custodians were in there. We have issues, we just don't have major issues. We had one period of time when Richland Northeast didn't have water, but it was because they cut the water off, not because it was a break. But they cut it back on, it was only off for a couple hours. A lot of roof leaks. Our folks have been in there. We will continue to identify roof leaks, and with staff and teachers back in the buildings, we'll have a few more issues, but we're on top of them and trying to stay ahead of them. The really big issue, we had a big sinkhole in the access road into Perrone. That is already repaired. They're actually digging up my bus parking lot. I had a bus to start go through the asphalt because it was undermined because of the storm drain line. The two big areas, the two biggest concerns were at Ridgeview. One was on the corner of the practice field, and one was next to some new football bleachers that we'd put in. It really literally stopped raining on Monday. On Tuesday morning, we had the civil engineer and the contractor. We did an emergency procurement on the contractor. The civil got his design back to us on the 8th, and we had a pre-con on the 9th, and right now, They did some fencing down there to make sure kids couldn't get into the washed out areas. They delivered some materials, and we're looking at 4 to 6 weeks. And part of that's curing time for the concrete, because we've got to repour the concrete road before we, so part of that's curing time. And with that, I'll turn it over to Katina, unless you have questions, or we just do them at the end?
Let's do them at the end.
Fine. Jack, if you just want to stay up there, though, so when she gets done, we'll thank you. Sorry.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Hamm, it gives me great pleasure to share with you our relief efforts thus far. You'd be interested to know that Monday, after that weekend flood, we had staff out delivering food to families. Abby Cobb actually waded through water to get to one family. Today, I received a call from Esther F. Garrison School of Visual and Performing Arts. From a parent of a second grader. The parent is in Savannah, and her child wanted to help. So we have actually begun, and we are going to continue our efforts. On Tuesday of last week, we got a little bit more organized after that first day of Abby wading through the water. We started working with Jack and Sodexo to plan out how we were going to respond as a district. We planned a conference call with the Learning Support Services staff in Richland too, which includes our school counselors, psychologists, our interventionists, nurses, social workers, because we wanted them to be available on all 10 campuses so that we had someone there that could not only address the physical need, but also the emotional needs of our students. So we sent that out, and we had overwhelming response from staff. And when our principals found out about the need for support, they also asked to be included, and we had an overwhelming response from them as well to help out at the 10 schools. Students and staff started drives, as you know, at many of our schools, and we had an overwhelming response, as Dr. Hamm shared earlier. And I also want to recognize the ESOL team from Nancy's team. They actually made sure that we were addressing the needs of our Hispanic families. Nancy and I spoke during the week to make sure that we were addressing them and making sure that we were getting folks out into the community wherever they were needed. We received numerous donations from local businesses with air mattresses, food, water, tarps, cleaning supplies, and Harvest Hope in partnership with South Carolina End Child Hunger Project. They provided several hundred boxes of food and water to our community. We had staff members impacted, but those same staff members got out and started working to help others. If you see there, Denise Webster, her house was flooded, but she was out feeding families and helping out where she could. And I also want to recognize, and a little birdie told me this, that Dr. Hamm worked in the community, and we greatly appreciate a large financial contribution that really helped the school district purchase a large amount of food and supplies on Friday, and we want to extend a heartfelt thank you to her in leading the way in our community. We actually received, as you can see from around the community at schools, an overwhelming response of water. We had clothes, and we are continuing to work together to go through all of those items so that we can sort them out to families that are in need. And we've also received support from the Richland II Education Foundation. They're actually going to assist us by collecting the relief funds so that they can have a place to go and have a place where we can also manage them very carefully. The schools have actually started working on a special project where we're asking them to focus on our school food pantries and also our backpack program. Each school has received two or three items that we're asking them to collect over the next few weeks so that we can have those pantries and backpacks prepared and ready to go. We know we're going to have more families that need assistance. We're continuing to work with families. The Learning Support Services team prepared a four-page document that included what schools should do to be prepared for yesterday. So when principals arrived on Monday, they knew they were going to have support from the mental health professionals on their campus. And this team that you see up here, they prepared that document. In that document, it also included mental health needs, counseling services that are available in the community, how to get your health care needs met. So there were plenty of materials available for our staff and especially our principals as they were working to lead their schools through the situation. And here's a picture of Long Creek that I received today. And as I placed there, stay strong, and that's what we're going to continue to do, and we're going to support our schools and our staff in our efforts. We're going to continue to focus on not only the physical needs, but also the emotional needs of our students. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It would have been really nice if I'd have had that comprehensive communications plan in place by last week, but it wasn't there, but it didn't matter because we had a good structure in place and I think we were able to deliver information. I always try to over-communicate in this situation and clarify as much as you can, but we used our automated system was our primary way of notifying. And that means we called every household that we have an accurate number for and email. We also used our website and our social media. So we made calls every time we made a decision about closing school or delaying school. And then the website has been primarily used this week. We created a two-hour delay information page because this is much more beyond what we're used to dealing with the two-hour delay of snow, maybe a day or two. But this is very different from those types of inclement weather. So we have an information page that we've continued to update, as well as provide resources, links to maps, and information to our parents. Since our call about the two-hour delay went out on Friday evening, we set up an informational line. We encourage parents to go to the website first and look for information. And they couldn't find the answer to their question. We gave them a phone number they could call where they left a message. And those were checked throughout the weekend. And basically, the emails have kind of come in throughout this time. We've received about 20 emails with questions on our contact us form. And we received about 50 calls from the hotline. Not a very official hotline, but a hotline. It worked well this weekend, and we were able to, I think, answer some questions before parents had to make some decisions and plans for Monday. So I think that was helpful. And 50 calls out of sending calls to 29,000 something numbers is pretty good. So I'm going to move on to the makeup day recommendations because outside of questions about boiled water and what time school actually starts, that's been probably the most popular question asked. And so as Mr. Manning and y'all have talked a little bit, we have to use our three weather makeup days. That's what they're there for. So we know that we will be going to school on February 15th, March 25th, and April 29th. Outside of that, we're trying to find ways to make up instruction time, even if that may not count as a makeup day, but find instruction time, especially in this first semester, because you'll see all those days are built in the calendar in the second semester, and we do that because we want to wait till winter weather passes. So we would recommend that what we're looking at is October 21st would be a full day for elementary and middle school students. That's next Wednesday, instead of an early release day. And that would not give us, it can't count as a day back because it's already being counted in your 180-day count, but it'll give you the instruction time back at those two levels. January 14th was also a half day for all students, and we would use that as a full day, and that would again give us back instruction time. Can't count it as a day, but it gives you back instruction time that you missed. Keeping October 22nd as a student holiday and a teacher work day, and October 23rd as a district holiday, except for our 245 employees, which already have to work. And we feel like this is due to the short notice, not only to our families and our employees, it would be challenging to have a successful makeup day. We might could get a day back, but would it be provide? Would we have enough students, or how would our absentee rate, as well as would we have enough staff? If we have teachers out, do we have enough substitutes? Or we have bus drivers who already had scheduled to be out or away, would we be able to have substitute drivers? And it's just not a lot of time to try to make those plans, especially when we're also still recovering. We haven't got to the point where we're back to our normal routine. Then we would recommend using January 4th as a makeup day. And this right now is listed as a student holiday teacher work day. It was, it's the first day we come back from winter break for employees. And now we would use that for a makeup day. And using this day would give us plenty of notice for families, more than a 2-month notice to families and employees. Allows us to make up a complete day, so it does count as a day. And of course, we recapture that instruction during the first semester. And we would anticipate right now, based on that calculation, that we would have to ask for a waiver over for forgiveness for one of the 5 days we missed this past week. But like Mr. Manning said, we would need to wait to actually do that recommendation and for y'all to take action after, of course, the winter months, because we may have more and we need to see. But this is a plan that would let us communicate some things to families so they can, we've got lots of calls coming in about the next week, and also it would help our teachers with getting back some instruction time. I have a slide of the calendar, but y'all have the calendar here, so I'll leave these up. And that was all for my part of the presentation, so.
I know I don't even need to ask, so more questions and comments. If it's okay, can I just start down at the end, and then we can just work our way down, because I'm sure everybody's got a question or comment. So, Mr. Jackson, if you want to start.
First of all, I think excellent job. I mean, it's been a tremendous amount of stress and strain, and for everyone involved trying to communicate such a fluid message, because the situations and conditions were so fluid, it's absolutely commendable. I mean that very sincerely. So thank you for a tremendous job. Libby or anyone, when you talked about, I was looking at the calendar, that's what helped me understand. And so we would keep students in school all day on Wednesday the 21st, but we would retain the holiday on the 22nd and 23rd. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That would be correct. One of the reasons for the whole day on 21st is we don't know yet about, and Jack can speak to this probably better than I can, but if we're on a 2-hour delay still next week, or mm-hmm. a 1-hour delay next week because of the roads, then we wouldn't be getting into school until, and then they'd come for an hour. So that's one of the main reasons too. I forgot to mention that. The fact that we may still be on a delay and it would make more sense. The 22nd is a professional work day and district in service. So we have a lot of professional development planned for teachers, and it actually counts as one of their 190 days. So you'd have to, if you use that, you got to find another day for them. and then the holiday. Yes, sir.
I was asking because I'm wondering, when you mentioned earlier about the other days not being changed because it's too short of a notice, I'm wondering is, why wouldn't the 21st changing the other direction be
right.
not be too short
it
of a notice?
It would be. We were hoping with a half a day, it might be a little more accommodating. We should not have the issue with employees because employees will be working. But parents, it would be challenging. But again, if we are on a two-hour delay, we really would need to make that right. a full day.
Okay. But if we're not, then, yeah. And
it gets back to that fluidness.
Absolutely, absolutely. And the January 14th would be a full day Thursday.
Yes.
But then Friday we would retain that.
As
a holiday.
As a holiday, because that is the end of the semester, and our high schools especially need, our guidance departments need that day to get in grades and adjust schedules and make plans. So we looked at that, but that was why we would keep that one.
Thank you so much for explaining it to me. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Good question.
Yes, sir. All right. Dr. Caution Parker.
This was a tremendous amount of work, and I appreciate it all. And I guess the other thing is, you know, I always believe in a plan A and a plan B. And we're getting ready to go into the winter months, and I do have a feeling we're going to be hit again. I would just think, or maybe just suggest, that we start looking at extending the school year in June. Go ahead and put a plan B in now, if at all possible, and I don't know how the other board members feel about that, just to be on the safe side. Just have some accommodation, because I don't think that we can touch spring break. I'm sure parents have made all sorts of plans and have forked out money, taking their children different places, whatever. But I definitely would think that we would need to look at extending the school year. Just a suggestion.
Ms. Brill? I mean, Ms. Mackey, I'm sorry.
Yeah, ditto. The hard work that Mr. Carter and you all have done, and Libby, I can't commend you enough on the communications. I am a communications addict. I love to have the more information, the better, and I appreciate what you had to do under duress. Question, I know there was some discussion about extending this 9 weeks, and I just think about students who may need to have all the grades in that they possibly can. There are some classes that have some testing at the end of the courses, and they need that instruction, so to have lost a week through no fault of our own kind of impacts some students with their classes and their grades. Consensus
at our
on that?
Principals meeting on Friday, we started that conversation with them and with our middle and high schools where it has the most impact, and asked them to please go back and look at, and I'm looking at Mr. Price because he led that discussion, but please go back and look and see and talk to your teachers, talk to your counselors. We didn't feel like we had to make that decision right then, and that would give them some time. So we're meeting with them again tomorrow and make some adjustments, we hope, just be able to decide on that. So we are looking at it, I guess.
And you'll let us know?
Absolutely. Yes. And there was one other thing I was going to say.
That's my parent hat. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, we will. We also... the question came up about end of course testing, which is a state date, and we're looking into
testing,
what flexibility,
AP exams, yeah.
what flexibility we have on those dates, and it's moving the semester itself back is a little more challenging than a 9 weeks, which is why we've we talked to the principals about that, and they decided that we would stick with the first semester ending when it does, but see what we might can do for the first 9 weeks. Is that accurate?
Yeah, make me understand that a little bit more.
If you look at January, where you see January 11th, 12th, 13th, that 14th is the half day and the 15th is the work day. That's basically the turn day for high schools to finalize everything from first semester, get everything loaded up for second semester, and be ready to start day one of the new semester when students return on the 19th. If we extend the semester, the challenge is now that you have the turn date for working before the last day of the semester one. That's the challenge. So the principals have gone back to their teams. They're discussing that challenge to try to determine what would be the best recommendation without the ability to move a work day to make that turn for the semester. So extending the first 9 weeks, as Libby said, is a little easier than it is extending semester one. So that's the challenge, and we're going to discuss that tomorrow and be ready to move forward with a recommendation at that time.
Thank you. Ms. Brill?
I just wanted to thank, I know, getting a lot of emails and information from Jack Carter, and I know how hard you and your staff have been working and going out when the weather was still very dangerous, and I can't tell you how grateful we are. And Katina and Libby, and it was a lot of communication, and I was busy packing up to go to my son, youngest son's wedding. So I was very half-hearted about leaving because, you know, we had a tragedy here in our own community and out of school an entire week, which is sort of unheard of, basically. And I'm leaving for a very joyous occasion, so I went with a heavy heart. But trust me, I had a good time. So that was the main thing. And I came back here to see that everybody has done a marvelous job, and the community has come together, and Good Samaritans going over to the Lake Catherine area and just volunteering to help people clean up and dry out and throw away. And the entire community has come together in such a fabulous way that makes me feel good about the human spirit and about what we can do as a community. So congratulations, and I'm really proud.
Thank you, Ms. Brill. Mr. Plank?
Just echoing what everyone else has said, and just that, you know, I see weary eyes, and this has been an emotional time. You know, these are, it's interesting to see what, you know, the devastation in a different way. We're somewhat used to hurricanes, and we're used to some of this wind and destruction like that, but to actually have this water damage in many cases where people aren't going to have financial protection as a result, and families who have been displaced, and how that impacts and ripples into the school. But so I appreciate everyone's extra effort, and you guys have worked so hard, so I'm thankful for that. And as far as questions, you guys have hit the concerns I had, so thank you so much for being that quiet hero. Thank you.
Go ahead. Dr. Elkins-Johnson.
I just want to say thank you to everyone for just pulling together and working together. I really appreciate that, so thank you very much.
Dr. Hamm.
Well, first of all, I want to make a minor correction to something that Tina Davis said, and she gave me credit for getting some funds for the district, and actually I want to make sure that credit correctly goes to Nelson Mullins Law Firm. They're the ones that scrambled and made the donation through our foundation, and I want to express my thanks to them. I come into this feeling very, very fortunate. We had virtually no damage to our buildings themselves. And we had some outside things that are being repaired within a month. And actually, there weren't a whole lot of our families or staff that were affected by this, although the ones that were badly affected in many cases. And one of the things that we saw that was so remarkable was the response of the community and our staff. You know, when somebody like Abby wades through the water to make sure people are fed, or Sodexo is set up and staff is there to make sure we're feeding people during the week, it's wonderful to be surrounded by really caring people who don't just do their jobs. They go beyond their jobs to make sure that we take care of one another, that we're a family and we watch out. And so I'm grateful for that, and I'm proud of that. I couldn't ask to work with a better group of folks, and I don't think we could have asked for a better response for the community to help make us all that happen. So I want to express my gratitude and a commitment that we'll continue not only to provide that kind of support, but also, you know, we have a neighboring district, Richland 1, that was hit very hard in other areas, and we need to watch out for them as well. And I hope and I know that that's something that we'll do. So thank you to everybody for their hard work, and I want to ask for everybody's patience as we move forward. Things are still changing day to day, and I know flexibility and patience are going to be things that we're really going to need. Thank you.
So just a few comments. One, I want to thank everybody. I mean, there were a lot of staff members working during the week that we didn't have school. All executive team was working to try to figure out how to address it. Jack had lots of staff at all different levels out working to check on the roads and check on our facilities, and Dr. Miley, you know, getting the emergency procurement put in place, and your staff was there to help us with the Ridgeview issue so that we could respond quickly. And I know we're often under attack for our reserve fund, but that reserve fund allowed us to move very quickly instead of having to seek loans or take money away from our classrooms to fix some of the issues that we do have. And so I'm thankful for the vision of the board to have those funds four times like this so that we can react quickly and ensure the safety of our students and community and Libby's group, and I know Tom's group with technology. It really took everybody to bring together all the pieces of communications and board members. I want to thank you all. I mean, we were all in communication with each other and trying to make sure that we were on the same page. I spent a lot of time on behalf of the board contacting other entities. I talked to Richland One. I know Lower Richland, I talked to some folks out there, having been a former teacher there, that's close to my heart, and they're really struggling and will be for a while there. And then, you know, also Forest Acres, where I live, that community, lots of friends and neighbors that are directly affected and just the things that I saw there. Also, the district is trying to work with Columbia Police Department and provide support for some things that they need. And so I appreciate the district really going out of our way to work with them. And so there's just a lot of pause. I want to thank our parents. I can tell you, being in traffic right now, it takes a lot of patience. And I know we've adjusted schedules, and I'm sure we'll have more communications about days. And so I hope the community will bear with us as we try to figure this out. This is a 1,000-year event. It's not like you have a communications plan written for a 1,000-year event, right? So we do the best we can to try to prepare. I would ask that maybe on our website, if we could check that's a little more mobile friendly. I know lots of people are using cell phones, and I checked on my cell phone and I couldn't read all the details there. So if we can maybe just double check on that. Again, not a complaint, just, you know, I know probably more people use that than they use computers now to check those things. And then just to keep us apprised as things change and move forward. Do I have any other questions or comments?
Follow up, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Libby, help me out on March. Look at your calendar for March 16th. It looks like we're going to go to school the 21st, 22nd, 23rd, get out a half a day for elementary and middle on the 24th, then come back on the 25th. Is it not possible to reverse that and just rather than make the 24th an early release, make it the day? And maybe that's not a question for you. I don't know. I guess it just seems like, you know, we're going to be in school, we're going to have a half day out, and then we're going to come back for Friday. And then we're going to be right after that, the next week we'll be on spring break.
Right, right.
In and out.
And it's the elementary and middle. So it may be that we look at that day as the day to make it a full day. I'm not sure we could, because the high schools are on it. Everybody will be coming back on that Friday, so that would not help the high schools.
Right.
So maybe we need to just look at.
But everybody's going to be on spring break starting that Monday, though, the elementary and middle. That's where I'm coming from.
Right.
So, and actually, Mr. Jackson, just to kind of jump on to your
point,
you know, I think we have a lot more information that we need. We don't know if the state's going to forgive days. The legislature still has that ability to do that during the emergency. Mm-hmm. I think we need to check with the State Department on end of course tests, because this was a statewide issue. I know it didn't affect every district, but affected a large number. Are they going to push some of those days back? Because if we add time at the end of the 9 weeks, we will get the instructional time, but we'll have missed all the windows that were key for testing in order to prepare the students for that. So while we do get some benefit, we miss the bulk of the benefit by moving it to the end of the 9 weeks. So I think maybe we don't have all the information. And if we put dates out there that we're making it up and then the state forgives some or shifts things, I just want to be careful about, I want to give them enough time, but not have to retract it. Once we put it out there, we'll create more confusion.
Right. What we'll do is we'll look at the combination of days to make sure that doable for our families.
Gotcha.
The 25th has always been listed as an inclement weather makeup day.
Sure.
And we've coupled that with the half days because if it's a holiday, the parents like that.
But
we'll look into that with the elementary and middle schools. The forgiving of the days with the legislature, based on what we got from the State Department, we believe that they will just defer to this law. But you're exactly right. They could decide to do something. They could introduce something in January that nobody knows about. But the state superintendent did, you know, was go on the media and actually sent us clarification that schools should plan on using their three weather makeup days. The biggest thing I think on our end right now is answering the questions about October, the next week, which we'd like to be able to go ahead and say the 22nd and the 23rd are going to remain as they are on the calendar, because that's we've said that's what we think, but we wanted to have this discussion tonight with y'all. So I think that would be the biggest thing, and using January 4th to go ahead, even if they forgive days after January, that 4th gives us a day back before in the first semester, which we wouldn't get until they come back in January. So if that's okay, I'd like to go ahead and tell parents that the inclement weather makeup days will be used based on what we know as the law is now, and that next week, October 21st, will be a full day for elementary and middle. 22nd, 23rd will remain as it is on the calendar. The 4th will be a day we come to school, and the 14th will be a full day. So I think those things, if I could get those communicated now, would help parents in planning if there's not a big objection to doing that.
Okay. And we'll chat with the State Department if they're looking to maybe shift.
Yeah, I'm sorry, that was the last thing. It is, my brain starts forgetting stuff I need to written down. Yeah, I was leaning over and asked Dr. Sheely. We've asked about that, EOC and some other, and we're just waiting to hear back from them. So we haven't heard yet. And one other thing I want to add, I'd be remiss if I didn't recognize our partnership with the library came in very handy because working with Martha Jones, who has a good contact there, one of our fears was, you know, sending this call out and relying on parents to go to the website to get the information they needed. And we know that not every family has that access in their homes. So we worked up a flyer that we sent to the to the library, who shared it with branches in our area, so they could have information in their branches this weekend that said we were going back to school and here's the website, so people who were in the library could get that internet access. And we included that in our message, because that was one of the biggest concerns, making that announcement on Friday so they could plan, but then having a way to make sure people got all the information. So we want to thank the Richland Library for being very helpful. They agreed. They said, send us the file and we'll take care of it. So they were very helpful.
Okay, Jack. Thank you, Libby.
Point of clarification on two things. One is the hand sanitizer. Actually, Mayor Benjamin helped us get that, so we need to give them credit for that. The $300,000 I put up there are for the big items. We've subsequently found a couple of small places in gyms that have had some leaks where we're having to repair the floor. We did have the insurance adjuster out. We are covered. Dr. Miley looked into that. We are covered. We are not in a floodplain where we have the major damage. So if all of that goes through, and he was very optimistic as the adjuster that most of those claims would be valid, that we have a $50,000 deductible. So, that might be our total exposure, but we're going to do everything that we're doing. We're keeping track of it. We'll do it as one submission so that we maximize that $50,000 deductible.
Thank you, Jack. Board members, if y'all don't mind, we're going to go to the next item, which is the agenda item. And I'll allow for any public participation. If you don't mind, since we all kind of had an opportunity to comment and staff needs to get home, it's probably already later than we should have everybody out. We won't do board and superintendent comments unless you have any major objection to that. Okay, thank you. All right, so Dr. Hamm, agenda items.
On the 27th, we'll meet at Muller Road Middle School. We'll have a student focus, an update on R2I2. We'll have the report on the feasibility of on-campus stadiums. We'll have a report on the first quarter financial statement, a report on the district priority for diversity and multicultural inclusion, and a report on college and career readiness that'll focus on our career and technology education programs and AVID.
Board members, any other agenda items for this or future meetings? All right, thank you. Do we have any public participation? Anybody that would like to speak to the board? Come on up. Thank you. Remember to state your name and address.
Good evening. I'm Myra Cunningham, and I live in the Northeast area. And I am a proud Ridgeview parent, as well as auntie supporter of Ridgeview High School. And I am want to speak with you all just for a few minutes regarding the damage that was done to Ridgeview's stadium. I'm also a member of the Ridgeview High School PTSO and the SIC, as well as the representative for the Superintendent's Parent Advisory Council. Also, as you know, Ridgeview was damaged, the field was damaged during the storm of 1,000 years, and it has been assessed at well over $250,000. And we are having to use a different field. And so I wanted to know, as a parent, as from the, representing the PTSO, the SIC, and the advisory, what is the guidance from the district with regards to reimbursement from the funds that are going to be lost because we won't be able to generate funds from the ticket sales through use of the junior varsity team, as well as the concessions stand sales from the use of the field at the particular at Ridgeview High School, because now those games are going to have to be played at a different field. And so does the district have any guidance or policy with regards to reimbursement for the school? Secondly, for the past 14 years, Ridgeview High School has been using the district stadium that is located at Blythewood High School, but it has since been directed to use the stadium at Westwood. And this is going to cause an undue hardship for the Ridgeview students, the Ridgeview community, as well as additional transportation cost for Ridgeview. So is there a policy or is there any guidance for offsetting the additional expenses that the school will incur as a result of this predicament that we find ourselves uniquely placed in?
And Ms. Cunningham, you know we normally don't answer the public comments. Okay. Jack, I saw you raise your hand. Did you want to address this, though, out of the ordinary?
I'm not sure where the Westwood thing came from, because Blythewood is still available. The district stadium at Blythewood. Now, it might be tonight's game against Dutch Fork. I think we did make some schedule adjustments, but Ridgeview will still be going to District Stadium too. As far as the JV, we back when we had some issues at Northeast and we were doing some work over there, the district picked up the cost of the transportation to relocate. And so for a JV game that would have been scheduled at Ridgeview on their field, they can still practice on the field. They lost a practice field. They still have their main field, which is where they do most of their practicing anyway, and they have the lower field. We'll pick up the cost of transporting the JV B squad folks to, and we'll probably have them play in District Stadium too, and we'll pick up that cost.
So that helps with some of that. I think one thing that I would like to see on future agenda, Dr. Hamm, is sort of, I know different schools have different revenues based off size and other factors. I think that that's something that we need to take a look at, not just particularly for Ridgeview, but
absolutely
district-wide, something that I'd like to see us address and take a look at how we maybe rework that a little bit or where we are and get some numbers. So I appreciate your comments. Thank you very much. Absolutely. All right. At this time, can I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
So moved by Ms. Brill. Second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Plank. We're adjourned. Thank you.